Hi, guys.
Hi.
We're finally here
at UK Board Gamer Expo 2022.
And now we're going to show you our impressions of our first UK Games Expo. Let's go. Hi, we're here at the Hachette Board Game Stall, and I'm talking to
you. Correct.
And we're talking about a few games they're setting up here and also selling, I think.
So, yeah, Imagination Gaming would like a bit there, but not that.
All right, cool. So, one game which we just played is, which we really, really enjoyed. It's got a Japanese theme to it, and it's also been nominated for an award. Can you tell us what it's
won? It's nominated for the best European-style game. Yeah, so very exciting.
Cool.
Yeah.
Very, very nice. And so what other games do you have around here?
So we've got lots. We've got 18 tables set up here for a range of tastes. But yeah, I guess the other ones we've got nominated for awards. We've got Ultra set up just there, Secret Identity. We've got Shamans hiding behind one of those banners, and we've got several tables of Acropolis set up. It just released yesterday, in fact, that one, and that one's up for Best Family Game here as well.
Okay, so, nice.
You
should also play that one.
Yeah, please do.
And which one is your personal favourite?
Depends what mood I'm in, but I'm a Euro gamer at heart, so EG is... I've got a bit of a soft spot for EG, let me put it that way, yeah.
Awesome. So anything else we should know or anything else we should try apart from EP?
I would love to show you whatever you're interested in. Acropolis has been really popular here. Mandragora also released yesterday. That's another one. It's a new game from Bruno Catala, co-designed that one, released here. So again, it's been really popular. Happy to show you either of those. And that's Flavian.
Awesome. Thanks a lot for the interview.
No, thank you for stopping by, folks. It's been lovely to meet you. Yeah. Thanks, everyone.
You're not in Tokyo.
Even got King of Tokyo here in real life experience, and now we need to see if I can beat Alex.
Studios, and we just played the new Catan Dawn of Humankind, and I'm here speaking with Kelly.
Hi.
Hi, nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
So can you tell us a little bit about the new Catan that's about to come out?
Yeah, so Catan Dawn of Humankind is a reboot of an older Catan game called Settlers of the Stone Age that came out in 2002. It's been completely rebooted, refreshed art, some tightened up gameplay, really, really great components, and just all around a really nice new edition.
Awesome. And when will it come out, actually?
In October.
October. Will it be released at Essen?
That's a question for Cosmos, because okay. We produce Catan in English, and Cosmos goes to Essen and we don't.
Okay, all right. So it might be there in German.
Yes.
You can try it out. Cool. And so what do you like about this Catan? What do you like more compared to some other versions of Catan?
Sure. Well, I love that it feels a lot like base Catan. If you can play Catan, you can play this game really easy. It, to me, feels a lot like Starfarers, and Starfarers is my favorite Catan game, but it has a lot of the movement and a lot of the exploration. So it has that those mechanics, but in this really, really beautiful setting of prehistoric world before humans have really had the chance to make their mark on it.
Right. Awesome. And now, what's the target audience for this game? Would you say more advanced players, families, mm-hmm. or both?
Well, I've seen all different kinds of people playing it here at UK Games Expo. The primary target is people who generally play Catan or board games. It's a pretty medium weight. It is more advanced than base Catan. There's more going on, but it's not a ton more. It's probably easier to pick up than Cities and Knights. So it's right. a really nice medium Catan game. It's really friendly for just about anybody.
Awesome. I think Cities and Knights is my personal favorite. I really want that one.
Yeah.
Do you have a personal favorite?
Starfarers is my favorite. Yeah. It's so fun. I just love the aliens and the encounter cards and the pirate decks.
Yeah.
It's great.
Yeah, cool. We tried that last year at Essen. You have it here as well.
Yes.
Yeah. Maybe we'll play that again. Okay, anything else you want to tell us? Or?
No, I'm just so happy you guys came here. This is our first show back in convention times, and it is so awesome to be back at shows and playing games with
you. Yes, for sure. Thanks so much, Kevin.
Yeah, it's nice to meet you.
Okay, we are here at Alicat Games together with Mike. Hi, Mike. Nice to meet you.
Yeah, hi. Nice to meet you.
And I would really like to know, what kind of games do you have here at Alicat Games?
All kinds. It's I think Cesar's original inspiration was to make sort of science-themed, sort of educational-style games, but that's quickly bloomed into all kinds of family games, Euro games, small pocket games. I'm not sure there's really a single theme, a single subject, but he seems to be very good at picking the right products, working with the right people, and making some really, really good products, really good games.
So we just sit recently on your table and played Dice Theme Pod.
Yep.
Can you tell us something about that?
It's a dice manipulation puzzle game, sort of in the spirit of Dice Hospital, a previous game. The thinking is we might have a sort of a line of different games in of a similar style. The brief for me as the developer of that game was something very specifically that would appeal to the fans of Dice Hospital, that would repeat that experience of fairly light, friendly interaction between the players, but having a really interesting puzzle to solve. But a different kind of puzzle from last time. And this time, it's a step up in complexity in terms of the thinking and the brain burn that it gives you.
And so where does this idea came from to make a theme park theme, so to say?
I think that was part of a conversation that Cesar had with the original designers who pitched the original version, Daryl and Adrian. And they were talking about Dice Hospital. Cesar was kind of loosely inspired by the old computer games like Theme Hospital.
Yes.
And there's the theme park.
Theme park world.
There was an old theme park games as well. So yes. Sort of leaning into some that sort of nostalgia.
I played a lot of that game when I was younger on the computer.
So he had a conversation with Daryl a long time ago about, I want a theme park game, pitch me a theme park game. So they went away and did that and brought that to us. And then it went into development. So.
And what kind of people you would recommend theme park, Dice Theme Park to?
Yeah. Anybody who played and enjoyed Dice Hospital is going to love it, certainly, but it's got a broader appeal than that. We've had tables running here 3 days, and it just hasn't stopped with people queuing to play, wanting to play, and everyone's enjoying it. Families, experienced gamers, anybody who likes that kind of puzzle, they'll enjoy that.
And what's the game here at the stand, what you like the most personally?
Of the games here. I really like it. I'm really proud of it. I'm happy to play it. I quite like Autobahn here as well. I quite like heavy games too. I've known Fabio for quite a while. And that's a great game too. Amon Reyes are coming up as well. I like Egypt as a theme. Anything with Egypt I really, really like. It's great.
And the Dice theme park, when will it be available on the European market?
I'm not sure. I'm just a freelancer, so I don't get all the information. But it was originally kickstarted last year. It's now shipping to backers right now. I'm seeing pictures on social media, everybody getting their copies and they're starting to play it. I haven't got my copies yet, but hopefully soon. And then there'll be a retail version going, I imagine, end of the summer. It'll go retail. We have it for sale at Essen.
So will we see you in Essen?
Yeah, we'll definitely be at Essen. Yeah, that's an annual pilgrimage for me. I'm always there.
Okay, that's very good.
A big part of my process as a designer is just being aware of what's happening and seeing the latest releases and what's working, what's not working, what people are talking about, and that's definitely the place to do it.
So you will be with Alley Cat Games in Essen then as well?
Yeah, I'll do some time with Alley Cat Games, probably also with Bright Eye as well, so I have some games with Bright Eye here today. They'll also be at Essen, I'm sure, as well. And on maybe other projects too. I'm talking to a few other companies about maybe some other things. We'll see.
Okay, so if you'd like to see him again, and also maybe Dice Theme Park, then you can also see it in Essen, I will be sure. And thank you for your time.
No problem.
And have a great day.
Yeah, and you. Yeah.
Today we are going through Poetry for Neanderthals. Unk. Poetry for Neanderthals is a guessing game, encouraging communication, team-based game. My phone's gone. Team-based game. So ideally there'd be another person here. So for a hypothetical reason, yourself and
Toby,
cameraman, hi there. Toby's behind the camera there. He's a very good young man. He's good at guessing. Don't know why I'm going off on that subject. We have a timer, we have some cards. These cards all have words and phrases on them. There's a 1 point phrase and there's a 3 point phrase, okay? Effectively, if we were teaming up and Toby and the chair were the team, Toby and the chair would have the bash stick.
Right.
Their job would be to make sure we get it right. And how he makes sure I get it right is I don't use more than one syllable words.
Ah.
Okay, Neanderthals, ugh. Effectively, what I'm gonna do is turn the timer over again. It's running, but let's say today it's running. I'm gonna go then pull my card out and I'm gonna go on, head, where,
hat.
1 point in the score chart. Wet.
Water.
Oh. Tooth.
Mouth.
Eat.
Bite.
In. Arm. Body. Oh, body. Two words. Two syllables. What? If you get it wrong, it goes in the minus. Time over. And then you move on to the next person.
Like 3 minus 1 would be 2 points.
2 points.
Okay.
So yeah, then. And then you move on to the next team. They do it. Go in how many rounds you want. And then,
easy enough.
There is a little bit more to it. There are other cards inside here, which give you different things. Smell of grabs, got garden. I haven't gone through those as much. But again, we do have the rules out here if anybody wants to get a bit more in depth into it. But that was just a basic synopsis of the game for you.
And that one's already on sale?
It's on sale, yeah. We do have different version there.
Ooh, okay.
That's the after water, 9 o'clock. After 9 o'clock version.
Yeah, thanks for showing us.
That's all right, anytime.
Hey guys, we're here with Pirates of Penryn, and we're playing Dice Splice, and I'm gonna have my go. Okay, so I need to stack all these. No direct match.
No direct match.
So if you can put 3 on there, matching colour or symbol, good luck.
Let's try. I can put this on here.
That's right.
Oh, it's really high already. Okay, do that.
That's one.
This one I can put on here.
Yeah.
Oh,
it really is wobbly. Yeah.
Two.
And.
So hard, okay.
That's 3. Oh, no!
Almost.
6.5 hours later.
Oof. So, we basically managed to get through the first day of the UK Board Games Expo, and now we are heading over through this little area of nature to the Hilton Hotel. And there's like, yeah, what do we find there?
It's like a board game library, hopefully, from what I've seen, and we can play some board games until midnight.
So, let's see what's going on there. Okay, cute.
Day 2.
Hey guys, good morning.
We are here at City of Games, and they have the Isle of Cats, and also they have some drawings of little Isle of Cats, and we need to show this to you. Isn't this good? Okay, we are here in Hall 1 at Mighty Games right now, and I'm here with Nick. Welcome.
Thank you.
Nice to meet you. And today we want to see a little bit of the game Hamlet. And Nick, maybe you can describe us what it's game about.
Sure. So in Hamlet, we are trying to build our Hamlet out to become an official village. To become an official village, you have to finish building the church. And you can see in the Kickstarter version, there are little church model pieces. Every time you deliver to the church, you can add another piece to show it growing. You'll be adding tiles to the map to grow your village. You'll be activating them. Some of them give you resources, some of them give you points. You'll be building bridges in between and generally trying to get the most points, because it's a competitive game, so you want to get the most points by the end. As soon as the church is complete, that finishes the game, and whoever's contributed the most will be the winner.
So, and with how many players you can play it?
So it's 1 to 4 players, so there is a solo mode as well, and it will play up to 4 players.
And how long does it take usually?
So it's roughly 25 minutes per player. The first, so a two-player game lasts maybe an hour on your first game. Four-player game, we can play in an hour and a half to an hour and 3/4 once you know.
And for what kind of players you would recommend the game?
It's a midweight kind of game. It's simple mechanics to start with, and it gets more complex as you go through the game. So it's quite thinky, but you know, thematically it's very, very simple. But yes, if you involve like the kind of games where you have to think, plan ahead a few moves, then yeah, that's the kind of game you want to play.
And what can you tell us, when is the game released and when can the people get a hands on it?
Yeah, so this finished on Kickstarter a few months ago, and so it is going to be in production soon, and then it will come to retail around about November time.
Okay, thank you very much, Nick.
Thank you, guys.
And have a great day.
Thank you.
And I'm talking to Fabio, who designed the game behind me, which is called Autobot. So, is it still on Kickstarter, or was on Kickstarter?
It was on Kickstarter last month.
Right.
It will be at Essen this year.
At Essen. Yeah. Awesome. You can pick it up at Essen. And I've heard it compared to Ticket to Ride. Is there some Ticket to Ride influence there?
Not really. I mean, you build roads. So same idea, but it's a bit more complex than that.
Okay.
It's closer to games like Brass.
Brass, Birmingham. And do you collect cards, and then you spend those cards to build the roads?
You have a hand of cards. It's a bit like Concordia. You have a hand of cards. You play one card to do an action.
Okay.
Each card has a different color, not the color of the road you build.
Okay.
And then after you play your card, you can get back to it. So you can play one card at a time, and then you collect them back.
Okay. So you would recommend it for people who like Brass Birmingham, for example?
Yes, that's for that kind of
game. And so an expert game?
It's an expert game. It's like about 2 hour game.
2 hours, okay. Cool. And maybe last question, is this your first game, and how did you come up with the idea?
So it's, I had a few games before. This is a co-design with Nestor Mangoni, which is my friend. And we come up with this idea a couple of years ago. I wanted to make a game about Germany, because there are lots of German games about Italy.
They're
Italian, so they take many and then, because we go to Essen every year, and we're driving on the Autobahn, we got
to do nice story. So you came up with the theme first, and then you developed the mechanics.
Then let's see what we can do from here.
And it cannot be bought here, right?
We are still printing it here. So we'll be available in September, so we'll be ready at that time.
Awesome. Thanks very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, we are here now in Hall 1, I guess, and we are here with Andrew from Holy Grail Games, and we just have come along here with Encyclopedia. So Andrew, what is this game about?
So Encyclopedia is a game where you are a naturalist. You're going around the world trying to find animals, to research them, and then you're going to publish your research in a journal. It's a dice placement and set collection game. So at the beginning of your turn, you draw out four dice. Those dice are going to be of different random colours. You roll them, you put them on your board, and then you're going to use those dice and other people's dice to basically go around the world, find animals to do research on. You're then going to do expeditions to research them, and then you're going to publish your journals for everybody to read about your research. The value of the dice is important, the higher the better, because it allows you to basically get more research points to look into animals' traits. And the colour of the dice is important because on the board down there, any blue animal, for example, from Europe, you need to have a blue dice to research, okay? You can also have money and expedition tokens to let you manipulate the value and the colour of the dice. And then when you publish, basically you're taking off the research that you've done on your reference animal, and any animal that shares traits with it, you get to publish at the same time. So you're kind of rewarded for being as efficient as you can in terms of your publication. The game also allows you to use other people's dice. So everybody rolls the dice, everyone puts them on their board, but you can use yours or anybody else's. And if you use anybody else's, they get a little benefit for you doing so. So they might get some money, they might get a little bit of an advisor who comes and helps them with doing their research and such. And then at the end of the game, you basically tot up your victory points and whoever has the most wins.
Okay, cool.
Absolutely.
That's
no problem.
So, is this like a new game? Is it on Kickstarter? Is it in retail?
So, the Kickstarter has ended for this one. It's going to be going out to the Kickstarter backers in September. In October/November, that's when we're expecting it to go to retail. So, basically, we're pushing this out to have this out by the end of the year. And anybody who goes to Essenspiel, we're going to have a copy of this for sale at Essenspiel as well.
Okay, cool. And will you think that we will see you guys also maybe in Essen?
Yes, definitely we'll be in Essen.
Oh, that's good.
We'll be in Essen
as well. You can check it out in Essen then.
Yeah,
soon. And for how much players is it?
So this is you can play it as a solo mode or up to four players.
Four players. Cool. So thank you very much for the explanation.
No problem.
And have a great day.
Yeah, you too. Yeah, thank you. You too. Take care.
Bye. Hey guys, we're here at another booth. It's Fallix Games. And
hello.
I'm talking to, could you say your name again?
Valdemar.
And he's got this game. Brett Wilder.
Let's speak it correctly in German. Brett Wilder.
Great. Can you tell us a little bit about this game?
It's a game, a react control game about Anglo-Saxon England. The four kingdoms, Wessex, Mercia, Northumbria, and East Anglia fight for dominance of Britain to become Brett Wilder. It means the Britain's ruler. But the Vikings are coming, so there is card controlled another obstacle that you can use to indirectly attack your colleagues from the board. Because you are all Anglo-Saxon kingdoms.
So area control, lots of fighting, battles.
You can choose a different path for the victory because you win the game by controlling certain territories, but also by meeting the objectives from a chronicle card. So as a ruler, you want to be remembered in the future from the chronicles.
Yeah.
And also you should make a few steps towards the Renaissance, trying to develop better agriculture, better military skills, so then when you are mobilizing your troops, they can fight in a better way than just your opponents.
Cool, very nice. And it's going to start on GameFound?
Yeah, on right? June 15th.
June 15th, cool.
Yeah, and it's going to be available in English, French, German, and Polish.
Oh,
and just for the starter, but also maybe in Spanish, Italian, and whatever other partners come and join our campaign.
So we've not played it yet, but the design looks really cool. We're going to show some pictures or videos, and thanks for introducing it to us.
Thank you for visiting us, yeah.
Now, a new category really for us this year, Best Digital Hybrid. The People's Choice Award. Trouble in Folklore Falls, the Detective Society.
Okay, we are here at the Detective Society, and I am here with Joey.
Joe, yeah, yeah.
Joe, nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
And I just heard a second ago that you won a prize for the best hybrid game chosen by the people. So let us know, what is it about?
The Detective Society is basically you get a load of physical evidence in a box and you've got to solve a crime at a very basic level. That is what we do. But nothing is ever fake, so it's all real evidence. So if it's a letter, you get a letter. If it's a photo frame, you get a photo frame. And we sort of mix that with digital tech. So you need to text characters, email characters, sometimes make a phone call to characters, and yeah, use all of that information to solve whatever's going on.
Wow.
Yeah.
So how does it work? When I'm just getting this this game here, what do I need to do as a player?
Right, well, so first of all, you open it up and you'll receive a note from the Detective Society. You always get one of these. It says, begin your investigation here. And usually there's a little note that tells you about what the case is. So in our first ever season, you're hired by the father of this lady who's a diplomat for the country of Morvaria, but she's gone missing. He messages you and he wants to find out where she is. So you're working for him, the note comes from him, and you basically solve where his daughter has gone. Yeah, that's what you do. A good example of a puzzle that we've written. Do you want to see this?
Yes, sure.
Okay. So this is a letter from Save the Kittens to a man named Mark. You've basically got to work out his email address. Everything that you need to work this out is on this letter just here. So it's a little logic puzzle, basically. You've got to work out that these splodges that have been caused by the paper printer jam at their office are the same throughout the letter. So the first one correlates to this number just up here. This one is the same as this one. And this one is the same as this one. So you work out, obviously, there aren't many words that have E-N and then end in O-Y. So that must be a J, extra. Wow. And then you get another letter that tells you the address. And that gives you the whole email address.
Okay. And then you need to combine this kind of outcome with other evidences as well.
Yeah, so you use that to log on to his portal and then you get a little bit more information from that.
So how long does it take to play?
So it takes about 90 to 120 minutes to play one episode.
Okay.
You use everything in that episode to finish all of the objectives in that box. But then there's a little cliffhanger at the end that takes you onto a full season. And if you play the full season, it's about 9 to 12 hours.
Wow, yeah, that's huge.
So we've got four different series. They've all got different themes. One is about politics, one about, well, at a very basic level, one about politics, one about tech, one about an artifact that kills people, essentially. So it's a bit more supernatural. And our newest one, the one that won the award, is this one. So Trouble in Folklore Falls, which is about a fairy tale world. So it's like a film noir fairy tale where you help the big bad wolf to solve crimes, essentially.
Okay. What kind of sort is this hybrid thing now in this game?
Yeah, so basically, the reason that we have this hybrid effect is sort of you text the characters, you call the characters, you receive messages from them throughout the game. A lot of websites to surf through and a lot of digital content as well. A lot of chatbots, so you basically feel like you're talking to the characters. You can reach out to them and help them to solve these crimes.
That sounds really good. So thank you, Joe, for your short introduction. I'm also here with Dan now. Hello. He's the managing director, and you just won the prize.
Yeah,
so what's going on?
We won the People's Choice Award for Best Digital Hybrid, which is a new category at the UK Games Expo Awards. Absolutely amazing, can't believe it. I personally want to say a big well done to the team behind the games. Callum, Tom, Joe and Tristan did a great job getting things in order and getting things out there, and we're so pleased, so thank you.
Congratulations. So what do you think about, how many years have you worked on this right now?
And yeah, so it's our fourth game. This is certainly one of the biggest awards we've won, so it means so much. And it's just nice that people are playing it and enjoying it, and yeah, it's such a good feeling, so we're really pleased.
Absolutely deserved. And I just heard we will see you also in SM22.
Yeah, we'll be there, we'll have a booth again, and we'll be demoing games, so come along and see us.
So we can also expect that your game will be translated into German language.
Yeah, we hope so, yeah. Certainly got some translations on the way, which we'll have at the show.
Wow.
And we're constantly working on that sort of stuff at the moment, yeah.
That's great news.
Brilliant.
So let's check it out, and thank you, Dan. Thank you to your team, and great success.
Thank you very much.
All right, guys, this was it.
It's over.
Doors are closed. We're closing.
Yeah,
people
you can see
coming out.
Everything is done now.
2 days of Expo. We bought some very cool games. We played even more games. Now we're exhausted.
We've seen the awards, so we can tell you some of the games later that have been awarded. We saw a lot of game publishers, a lot of developers that we have been able to talk to. So stay tuned on our channel. We will bring you some more information on Instagram and YouTube. It was a great time. What do we have to say?
Now we're going to London, going to spend some more time there, and we'll see you guys in the next video.
Have a good time. See you soon.
Bye, guys.